You ever stop and think about what's really happening when you decide to buy something? I mean, it feels like a simple choice, doesn't it? But, you know, just beneath the surface, there's this whole fascinating web of hidden forces at play. So let's pull back the curtain together and see what's really pulling the strings on our choices.
Okay, so let's make this personal for a second. Think about your favorite brand of coffee. You know, the one that's your absolute go-to. Why that one? Is it really just the taste or the price? Maybe it's the way it looks on the shelf. That one little everyday choice. Well, that's the perfect starting point for our whole investigation.
So here's our game plan. First, we're going to frame this whole thing like a detective story. Then we'll dig into the clues. The power of price, what's objective versus what's just your opinion, how other stuff you buy matters, and of course, your income. And at the end, we'll put all the pieces together and crack the case. All right, let's dive right in. Time to put on our detective hats, well, our economist hats, really, and start figuring out what actually makes us want to buy something. So every good detective story needs a case to solve, right? For us, that case is elite coffee. And as we go through this, every single clue we find is going to help us answer one simple question. What makes us want to buy more of this coffee, or all of a sudden want to buy less? Okay, first up, let's talk about the most obvious clue of all. The one we all see right away, the price tag. I mean, it's probably the single biggest, most direct thing that affects whether we buy something or not. And this brings us to like a fundamental rule in economics, maybe the most famous one actually. It's called the law of demand. And honestly, it's super intuitive. It basically says that when the price of something goes up, well, we're probably gonna buy less of it. And of course, when the price goes down, we're usually pretty happy to buy more. Simple as that. So check this out. This table really shows what we're talking about with actual numbers. At say 100 shekels, you might buy just one bag of that elite coffee. But what if it's on sale for only 20? You'd probably stock up, right? Maybe buy 8 bags. It's a super clear relationship. As the price drops, the amount we want to buy shoots up. Now, if you took those exact numbers and just plotted them on a graph, you'd literally get a picture of this whole relationship. That picture is what economists call the demand curve. And it almost always slopes downwards, just showing that basic idea. High price, low quantity. Low price, high quantity. But come on, it can't just be about the price, right? There's got to be more to it. We need to dig a little deeper here. And while, yeah, your personal taste is a big deal, economists are really interested in the things we can actually measure, the objective forces that affect everyone's buying habits. So let's split those two things up. For example, saying this coffee just tastes better to me, well, that's totally subjective. It's your opinion and it's 100% valid, but it's really hard to measure that for a whole population. On the other hand, things like the price of other brands of coffee or how much money you make, now those are objective. They're measurable facts that affect a ton of people, and that's exactly where we're going next. So our first big objective factor is this kind of ripple effect that happens with other products. You might not even think about it, but the price of one thing on a shelf can have a huge, huge impact on whether you buy something totally different. And that brings us to our next clue, something called substitute goods. It's a fancy term for a really simple idea. These are just products you can use instead of each other. You know, like Coke and Pepsi, or taking a taxi versus calling an Uber. They're basically competing for the same spot in your shopping cart. Okay, so here's how it plays out. Picture this. You walk into the grocery store, ready to grab your usual bag of elite coffee. But right next to it, you see another brand, a substitute, is on a huge sale. Its price just dropped. What happens? Well, all of a sudden, your desire for that original, more expensive coffee probably goes down. I mean, why not switch and save some money, right? All right, so on the complete flip side of substitutes, you have what are called complementary goods. Again, simple idea. These are things that you almost always use together. Think about it. Hot dogs and hot dog buns, or a phone and its charger. They're a team. So for a lot of us, coffee and milk are perfect complements. Now, imagine the price of milk suddenly skyrockets. All of a sudden, that morning cup of coffee is just more expensive to make. So what could happen? Your demand for the coffee itself might actually go down. It's a lot like cars and gas, you know? If gas prices go through the roof, people might think twice about buying a big SUV. Okay, so we've got the price of the coffee itself, the price of its competitors, the price of things that go with it, but all of this really hinges on our final and maybe the most fundamental factor of all. Because at the end of the day, it doesn't matter how much you want something if you just can't afford it. And that's all about your income. This is really the bottom line for all our purchasing decisions, isn't it? You can't buy what you don't have the money for. Your income level basically draws a line in the sand. It sets the ultimate boundary on your demand and determines your purchasing power for, well, pretty much everything.
All right, our detective work is almost done. We've gathered all the main clues. So let's put all the pieces of this puzzle together and lay out the key forces that are really shaping what you decide to buy.
So to recap, we've got four key objective factors that are always at play. First, the price of the thing itself. Second, the price of other things you could buy instead, the substitutes. Third, the price of things that go with it, the complements. And finally, the big one, how much money you have in your pocket, your income.
And what's so cool about this is how all these factors work together. It's not just one thing. They create this sort of invisible web of influences that is constantly pulling and pushing on every single purchase you make, whether you're even aware of it or not. So I want to leave you with a little challenge. The next time you're in a store or online about to buy something, anything at all, just pause for a second. Now that you know this framework, see if you can spot those invisible forces. Ask yourself, what's really driving this decision?